Hello, welcome back. And this week we're covering chapter 11, and we will talk about contactors, relays, and overloads. This will be the last presentation for this semester, and moving on from here, we'll go with chapter 12 and 13 next semester for thermostats and electronics. Okay, so the objective of this week will be first, talk about contactors and relay. We did talk about them before, but we would like to emphasize their function. Why? Because they are a major part of our controls. If we ever want to have more automated controls for our components, we will always need to use some sort of a relay. A relay is a mean of communication between circuits. How do we troubleshoot them? We did cover that at some point. And some will also talk about overloads. Probably you guessed by overloads we talked either about circuit breakers or fuses, but we will elaborate a little bit. So for control, again, if we ever have to control two circuits, we always need some kind of a relay. Relay connect from one circuit to another. So if we think of controlling temperature of some medium, we will have to send a signal. That signal usually is low voltage, and the low voltage will go and control the high voltage, which in this sense going to be either an AC motor to cool or a furnace or a boiler to heat. So it's a communication matter between two circuits. That's why we need to use relays and contactors. So we'll talk about that overload. So contactors, again, used for control. They make or break a set of contacts, and I'll give you a few examples. So for a compressor and condenser fan motors, for example, they need some kind of control to make up the circuit. If this is my circuit for a motor, this circuit will be applied. We can apply some hot and neutral, but until this circuit is complete, we will never have a complete circuit between them. And actually, this is kind of incorrect. The relay will be here. And this relay will be closed by a coil. This coil is controlled by another input in here, be it the thermostat. Okay, so in a nutshell, it closes and opens a circuit. It can do one circuit or more than one simultaneously. It can close and open two or more circuits at the same time to give us the proper output. So this is a contactor, and this is my input for the coil. And these are the set of contacts that will be made once, you can see that one in the back, once this connection is made and once this coil is energized, it will pull in magnetically these contacts. And again, we say the contactor is a relay size more than 20 amps. Picture of the coil, and there's again a pin that goes up and down based on the current going through it. Okay, so coils for relays and contactors can vary between 24, 120, 208, 240, or 480. So they could be any voltage depending on how much power do you want to generate for that coil to pull in the contact. And usually they are marked outside the coil. So if you apply the wrong voltage, you might burn that coil. The contacts, it's a mechanical linkage. We still use some mechanical contacts for high energy connection. So these are my contacts, and we can have it connect or disconnect based on the magnet. So they operate mechanically using the amperage draw. The other thing that I would like to highlight is the distinction between inductive and resistive load. Inductive load is anything that has to do with magnetism. meaning coil, motor, anything that has to do with an electromagnet, that's an inductive load. So a motor is an inductive load. A coil is an inductive load. Resistive load, it's a non-inductive load, also called non-inductive. And that means that it could be only based on resistance. So that's, it could be a heater, light, that's a resistive load. So its main function does not depend on induction. Troubleshooting the coil can be always checked using the continuity or resistance, and rarely becomes weak because, again, it's not supposed to be pulling a lot of magnet. Contact has to be tested visually. You can look at the contact, make sure there's no rust on it, and sometimes you can spray them, and we can also there are some special cleaning paper for some contacts. The mechanical linkage is the armature or the component that connect the contacts mechanically. Make sure they're not loose or broken or sometimes bent. Sometimes we have replacement parts, sometimes we have to replace the entire component. Relays, again, same thing. It's open and close the circuit. They are done for smaller operation. So you will see relays for fan motors, condenser fan motors, start capacitor, control lockout. So they're usually small size, again, less than 20 amps. Similar to contactors, however, contactors are more amperage. Same as faulty contactor. We look at the relay, we look at the coil, mechanical linkage, and contact. So that's the contact of a relay. Again, this must be, let's look at the amperage here. This is 25 amps, so it's a contactor, it's not a relay. So basically, just the terminology. I don't think it's a big deal. You can always use those terms freely, either contactor or relay. It's the same idea, but usually contactors are meant for more than 20 amps. This is my contacts here. Usually they get a lot of stuff in them and they don't connect very well. And this is my coil. You can see it's a huge coil, so it's 25 amps, and probably this is to turn on a compressor. So that sums up the relays. So we have relay, contactors, and we have a magnetic starter. Magnetic starter is a contactor, but it has an overload protection, whether it's a fuse or even a breaker that will trip the circuit. So overloads, they protect us from high amperage draw. And probably now you have an idea of what will cause you to have high amperage draw. It is motor could be stuck or overheated, and that's when we have a lot of high amperage draw. So usually the fuse is the simplest way to have an overload protection. They melt, and they are designed for the highest amperage in the circuit, let's say 15 amps. If you exceed 15 amps, it will melt and you have to go and physically replace it. Fuses are meant for resistive load. Let's focus on that. Why wouldn't we put a fuse in a motor? Because the motor has big possibility of fluctuating amperage. So we usually put fuses on non-inductive loads, meaning usually on control boards or a load that is not going to fluctuate over time. We can also put fuses for surge. And again, the problem with fuses, we have to go and physically replace them. But again, they will cut off the power completely. And sometimes we use both fuse and a contact and a breaker. So let's look at the breaker fuses. Again, two ends of a piece that will melt. They are good for wires, circuit components, and non-inductive loads. Unless it's a safety issue and it's highlighted or recommended by the NEC, we usually use fuses always for non-inductive loads, which means also resistive loads. Okay, line break or quiet duty overloads. So line breaks, they break the power to the motor. that have bimetals in them, and they also use for internal compressor overloads. So usually you see those pilot duty overloads in some motors to protect against thermal overheat. So they will break some contacts when the motor get overheated. So let me try to explain. So if we have those two metals made out of different material, once it overheats, it will bulge, and this bulge will break two connection. So this is my connection. Once it arch, it will break that bimetal, and usually you can go and reset them manually, or they can be reset by themselves. So probably you see those a lot on magnetic starter. Is a relay, is a contactor with overload, same as before. It has a magnetic coil and have set of overloads. Once we overload the system or exceed the rated amperage, it will break the system either magnetically or using. So the bimetal relays, they will react to the heat and bend. Thermals also operate in heats. And we also have molten alloy. So we have three ways to break magnetic starter. One of them is the bimetal relay. Bimetal relays act based on the amperage, and they will trip a relay. The thermal relay is the bimetal one. They react with heat, not by amperage draw and solenoid. Molten alloy, it will just melt a piece of metal, and you have to go and physically replace that. Look at that. So this is a molten alloy, and this is my connection over here. Again, you can tell from the size of these pins, it's high amperage. So this part will break, and you have to go and it will melt, and we have to go and change that piece. Another molten alloy. This pin really is put against gravity. So once we melt over here, this part, it will drop, and once we want to replace it, we replace the entire pins with those strips over here. Troubleshoot for those breakers is ohmmeter. We check for continuity, and also we look for molting or charred parts. Push buttons and stations. These are basically small relays, and usually they trip once there is an issue with the circuit. They're easy to troubleshoot. Some of them, you'll see those push button getting popped in a fuse circuit or in a motor, especially with thermal switches. So again, they react with overload and they pop, and you can go back and push them. And these push buttons are small little relays that get activated and deactivated, whether by current or by temperature. This is how they function. This is how it, when it's pushed, when you push the circuit, it is completed. And sometimes they toggle, so if you push one, the other will be undone. And this is a parallel system with two push buttons. If you push one, one will reverse, and it will give you different line voltage reversal. So let's double check our knowledge. A coil is the component that's available in a contactor or relay. It generates small little magnet. Contactor is a relay with more than 20 amps. Contacts are the piece of the relay that make the connection. Current overload, they react with the amount of current by breaking the circuit. Fuse will melt once its capacity has reached. Inductive load uses magnetism. Internal compressor overload, they use either current overload or thermal overload. Line break overload, those for the main line, usually you find them in switchboards where they either melt or trip, and you have to go and check them. Magnetic overloads, they act with, it's a contactor with overload protection. Magnet starter, same thing. It's to turn on the equipment, but also it will trip if it has an overload. Mechanical linkage is a component of the relay. Overload, we're looking about amperage draw. Whenever we exceed the amperage, we will trip the overload. Pilot duty overload, it does with the startup amperage. It will monitor your amperage draw, and once you exceed it, it will trip. Push button stations, again, it acts as an overload. Once the circuit malfunctions, the button will be tripped and you have to go and reset it. And relays, same as conductor and magnet starter, they do control one circuit. Resistive load is non-inductive load, and that's the opposite of inductive load, and they are components or loads that do not use magnetism, like a heater or a light bulb. Okay, that concludes our material for this semester, and I will do a small assignment for this week. Thank you. Fact check. If the contactor fail, the system fail. Coil depends on the wire and how they are wound, so you can change the coil to increase its strength. Contactors are rated by amperage. Remember that. Contactors are made out of silver and cadmium. Those are the contacts inside the contactor. They need to have high conductivity, and it can diagnose the coil, contact, and mechanical. Just another review for some of the information.